Good morning, good morning. How many of you excited to be here today? Hallelujah. Hey, also, if you need a seat, I know that we've got some seats in the back. I want to encourage everybody to find a seat. And that way, if the spirit of long-windedness doesn't catch up with me, you know, you're comfortable. Amen. Amen. Again, just want to make sure everybody's got a seat. Come on, let's thank the Lord for Salira. Come on now. Hallelujah. Up high, Salira. Salira, don't leave me hanging. Salira, don't leave me hanging, girl. Oh, come on now. How many of you love Salira? Amen. Hey, how many of you, this is your very first time here on a Tuesday morning? Wow, let's thank the Lord for all of these first-time family members. Amen. We're so thankful that you're here today. We've just got an awesome day planned and prepared for you. I know we've got just a bountiful supply of groceries to be able to give away today. How many of you are thankful for that? Come on now. God has blessed each and every one of us to be a blessing. Amen. And let's do this. Let's pray. And because there's a lot of things that I believe the Lord is wanting to do today. And we want to make room for all that he has to do. Amen. Father, we thank you in the name of Jesus for who you are and what is in your heart for this day, for each and every person in this place. Father, right now, in Jesus' name, I invite you, Holy Spirit, just to begin to start moving upon this room and moving upon the hearts of each and every person that you have gathered here today, God. Father, we invite you, Lord. You said that you hold the hearts of kings in your hand and you turn them whichever way you wish, just like the river. And so, Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, we invite healing for those who need healing, miracles for those who need miracles, salvation, deliverance for those who need salvation, deliverance, and redemption. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, we just came through a weekend that is known for repentance. Say repentance. And redemption. And see, the beauty of repentance is not just saying you're sorry. It means to think differently than you've thought in times past. Anybody ever had one of those aha moments where the light of the Lord gets turned on in your life and you're like, I was going this way, I was thinking one way, and then all of a sudden I said, wait a minute, I've got it all wrong. It's this way, it's his way, it's Yahweh. Amen. And so repentance means to change our direction, but redemption means to buy back at a price. And see, the beauty is how many of you know we've been redeemed from the curse of the law? Psalm 103 says, let the redeemed of the Lord say, so. Come on, how many redeemed in the house this morning? Come on, let's say so. Say so. Say so. Amen. Because what you say is what you create. Hebrews 11:3 says, by faith we understand the world we live in was framed by the words God spoke. And see, sometimes your day just needs to hear you say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say.
So.
Come on, let the redeemed of the Lord say.
So.
Come on. And what I want to talk to you about this morning is resurrection. I want to talk to you this morning about the power of the cross. I want to talk to you this morning about the power of resurrection, because I believe that there's some things that God is wanting to do in your physical body as well as in your spiritual life. Amen.
Amen.
And how many of you are thankful for this past weekend celebrating Resurrection Sunday? Amen. And then this is just some of the things that are in my heart. And I'm just going to, I actually wrote down a couple things that we shared on Sunday that I felt to share this morning as well. And then we'll just see how the Holy Spirit leads us. Amen. Just by a show of hands, because I like putting a demand on the anointing. How many of you here right now need healing in your body? Physical healing in your body. Father, right now in the name of Jesus, you see each and every one of these hands up right now. So, Holy Spirit, I ask, Lord, that even as we speak today, you said, Jesus, that your words are spirit and life. And so, Holy Spirit, I invite you to come and begin to release gifts of healing and the working of miracles to each and every person here this morning in Jesus' name. I declare that everyone in need of healing will be healed in the name of Jesus by the power of the Holy Spirit. Because when Jesus walks into the room, he doesn't leave things undone. He finishes what he starts. Amen. He finishes what he starts. Amen. And when he hung on that cross and he said, it is finished. finished. And what he was saying was, your healing would have been purchased by his stripes. Amen. He was bruised for your iniquities. He was chastised for your peace. And I'm telling you, I think a lot of times we can make excuses and allowances in our life to have things that Christ died that we no longer had to have. Amen. And so today we lay aside every weight. Today we lay aside every sin. Today we lay aside all sickness in the name of Jesus and receive the full redemption, the full reward of the Lamb's sufferings. Amen. Give him a shout of praise. Hallelujah. And you see, everything that entered the earth when sin was first conceived in the garden was crushed at the cross, so that the fullness of our redemption could be experienced through the power of his resurrection. Amen. And I was praying this morning, I was looking back through a scripture in Luke 24, and there was really just one phrase that just kind of kept turning over in my heart as I was in the shower this morning and praying. How many of you like to pray in the shower? How many of you, God speaks to you in the shower? How many of you, God speaks to you in the bathroom? Amen? Hey, listen, deep calls unto deep at the sound of the waterfall. Amen. It's biblical. Amen. Luke 24, verse 1, it says, now on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they and certain other women with them came to the tomb bringing the spices which they had prepared. But they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. Say, rolled away. And see, each and every one of us, we could have a different stone in our life. We could have a different stone of accusation, a stone of regret, a stone of assumption in the lives of those around you. Anybody ever know what it's like to have a stone put on you? Yeah. Amen. To have somebody trying to hold you back from who you're called to be, trying to hold you back from what you're called to see. Amen. But I'm telling you, listen, not only did a stone roll away 2,000 years ago, I believe that God wants to roll some stones away today. Amen. And so it says the stone was rolled away. Then they went in and did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. And it happened as they were greatly perplexed about this, that behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. Then as they were afraid and bowed their faces to the earth, they said to them, why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but is risen. And how often in life do we seek the living among the dead? How often in life do we seek something that would give life to our spiritual man, give a change to our life, bring transformation in the lives of those around us among dead things, among dry things, among things in this world that are no longer producing? David said it like this in Psalm 119:37. He said, turn my eyes away from worthless things, that you would revive me in your ways. And really, what is the definition of a worthless thing? Something that does not add worth to you. And so how much of our life is surrounded by dead and dry things trying to distract us from a living God? Amen. Our lives are surrounded by notifications from this and that, distractions that bring distortion. And I think that the Lord is saying to us today, why do you seek the living among the dead? Why do you seek that which will bring you life among that which would take life from you? Amen. 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 Because he is not here, but he is risen. And see, they came with an expectancy that morning. They came with an expectation just to come and honor one who was. And they forgot that not only was he, but he is, and he is to come. Amen. Come on, give the Lord a shout of praise. It says in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 24, it says, he, Jesus himself, bore our sins in his own body on the tree. That we, having died to sin, might live for righteousness, by whose stripes you are healed. And see, the beauty of the cross, the power of the cross, the power of his resurrection is that you died to something. You died to sin that you could live for righteousness. In other words, we've died to this carnal state. We've died to this human nature. You know, how many of you ever heard people use an excuse for sin and say, well, I'm only human? Paul rebuked the Corinthian church for being mere men. What he was saying is, why are you carnal? Why are you setting your mind on things of this earth and not things above? Colossians chapter 3 says, if you've been raised with Christ, set your mind on things above, not things of this earth, that you be hidden with Christ in God. I want to tell you, there's a place of refuge. There's a strong tower. There is a secret place in the Almighty, under the shadow of the Almighty, that comes from setting our focus on things above, not things of this earth. Amen. Because when you begin to focus on things of this earth, you can all of a sudden become distracted. You can become disappointed. You can become discouraged. You can become depressed. Because when you look down, all you can see is where you are. But when you look up, you can see the hill from where your help comes from. Amen. And God is inviting us today to not look down at where we are, but to look up to where He wants to take us. Isaiah chapter 53, verse 3 says, He was despised and rejected by men. A man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we did not esteem him. Surely he has borne our griefs. That word grief means sickness, and carried our sorrows. That word sorrow means pain. He has carried your sickness. Say, He's carried my sickness. Say, He's bore my pain. It is illegal for you to take your sickness off of the cross. It is illegal for you to allow pain to be your portion when pain was ascribed to the man on the cross who became acquainted with sorrows. He was a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. Amen. And I don't care what the doctor tells you. I don't care what your body tells you. I'm telling you, the word speaks a better word. The blood speaks a better word. Amen. And there is a revelation of the blood of Jesus Christ that is coming back to the body of Christ into the church that we recognize. And not only is there power in the blood, but there is life in the blood. Amen. And just one drop of His blood is more than enough to cleanse the darkest of hearts, to cleanse the darkest of nations, to cleanse the most wayward son and daughter. Just one drop of His blood is more than enough. Amen. And we're talking about a Lord right now who loved you so much that when they tied Him to a whipping post and they began to beat Him, listen, they didn't just take a belt to His back. They took a cat of nine tails. That was nine strips of leather with pieces of metal and shards of stone and pots and clay on the end of it, to where when it hit His back, well, bam, it pulled the meat right out of His back. It didn't just leave a little mark. It wasn't a whooping. It was a beat down. And He said, listen, I'm going to take it because I recognize her healing and His healing is worth the pain. Amen. And with every strike, even though he felt that in His mortal body and in his body, listen, when He came, yes, He was God, but He chose to come as man. He chose to come as the Son of Man. He was not immune to pain. He was acquainted with pain. He endured every temptation that would ever come to you, ever come to me, yet He was without sin. Amen. He refused to allow the life that happened to Him affect the truth that He had in His heart, because He knew He was the life. He knew He was the way. He knew He was the truth. And He lived to a higher reality. He lived according to a standard, saying, listen, this world may hurt me, but it's all because I'm going to bring back the healing to those who have been hurt. Not only who were, but who would be. Amen. And so when he allowed them to take that meat out of His back, when those soldiers came and plucked His beard from His face, they weren't just pulling whiskers. There were chunks of His face that came out as they tormented the man Christ Jesus, to where He was beat beyond recognition. And I'm telling you, He didn't try to get out of it. He didn't try to say, no, I've had enough. It says, for the joy that was set before Him, He endured the cross. For the joy that was set before Him, He endured the shame. And I want to tell you, I see His joy right here today. I see His joy in your face. Come on, look to your right and see His joy. Come on, look over to your left and say, it was worth it. Because listen, He wasn't trying to get off of that cross. He was committed that even the people who put Him on the cross, He wasn't going to change the statement of His love for them. How many of you remember growing up with your children, or even as a child, where your parent would play that game of, I love you this much. I love you this much. If you've ever had a question how much God loved you, Jesus answered it as His hands were stretched as far as they could be. So much so that his shoulders dislocated and bones came out of socket. So much so that he was hanging by those nails, and the weight of those nails was causing everything on the inside, all of the fluids, all of the blood, all of the water, all of the bile and guile, all the things that were in him, just to be dumped in places they weren't called to go. But he said it was worth it, because he said, "You're worth it." He said, "I'm worth it." He saw that we were worth it, because he died as the body of Christ so that we could become the body of Christ. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. That word transgression means rebellion. That means when you know to not do something and you choose to do it anyway. Am I talking to anybody today? I know everybody else is thinking about somebody who's not here. Amen. He was wounded for our rebellion. He was bruised for our iniquities. You know the thing about iniquity? Iniquity is that sin that nobody knows about. Iniquity is that thing that's behind the scenes, beneath the surface. And really, what is a bruise? It's an outward blow that produces an inward pain. It's blood vessels that pop and burst beneath the skin. And he says, listen, if it's happening behind the scenes, I'm going to carry it behind the scenes. The chastisement for our peace was upon him. Peace came with a price. I want to tell you, listen, for you it's free. Paul said in Philippians, he told us how to live in a place of peace where peace would guard our hearts and guard our minds. And this is what he said. He said, listen, rejoice always. Yes. Amen. Let your gentleness be known to all men. But then he goes on to say this in Philippians 4:6, be anxious, be worried, be fearful about nothing. But in all things, through prayer and supplication, make your requests known to God with thanksgiving, so that the peace of God would guard your heart and your mind. And then he goes on in Philippians 4:8, he says, meditate on these things, what's true, what's noble. Listen, there's a lot of things that ain't true we're meditating on. There's a lot of things that are a lie of the enemy. They're a lie of the media. They're a lie of he or she or we. There's a lot of things that we're meditating on in a wrong way. And God wants the meditations of our hearts back. He wants the meditations of our hearts back. Said in Psalm 63, he said, when I meditate on you in my bed, how you've been my help in the night watches, therefore I shall abide under the shadow of your wings. And what David was telling us, there's a place of meditation. There's a place of contemplation. There's a place of pondering in our heart. Meditation is simply to think about over and over in yourself, to yourself, and to talk to yourself about the goodness of God. You say, well, people may think I'm crazy. Well, listen, you're talking to yourself about a lot of other stuff right now. So you might as well talk to yourself about the goodness of God. Amen. You ever had those conversations with people and you're the only one in the car? Well, I'm just going to tell them. Bang, chap, pop, pop. And people drive by and they think you're on speakerphone. And honestly, you just listen, you got a home group in that car in your head. Amen. And I'm telling you, listen, there's things that we justify in the flesh that we think are weird in the spirit. But I want to tell you, we're called to meditate on the goodness of God. We're called to declare the works of God. We're called to say, you know what? This may not look good. This one situation may not be good. This person may be talking about me. But God said, all things work together for good. Amen. For those who love him, and I love him, and those who are called, and he said that his gifts and his callings are without repentance. They're irrevocable. There's nothing that I can do that can reject the call of God on my life. And see, some of you may have been told that you blew it, that you were once called, but you did this, this, and this, and so God will never use you. I want to tell you that's a lie from the pit of hell. Yeah. Romans 11:29 says the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable. That means when he gives it to you, you cannot return to sender. You can say no and not walk in it, but he doesn't take it back. And somebody needs to hear that today. That the gift of God is still upon your life. The calling of God is still upon your heart. And if you'll pick it up and begin to run in this season, not only will you not have missed a step, but you'll pick up where you were and end up where you're going. Amen. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. Peace came with a price, and he paid it all. He paid it all on Calvary. It says in Mark 15, they led him to a place called Golgotha. Say Golgotha. And Golgotha was the place where they hung the three crosses. And Golgotha means the place of the skull. And see, the truth is, he had to die a death in the place of the skull, because it is in this place the enemy is always seeking to win the war. That's why Paul said to take every thought captive to the obedience of Christ. Amen. Everything that exalted itself against the knowledge of God in your life. He said, listen, I'm going to die a death here so that you can live a life here. So that you can live from your heart and not just from your head. The chastisement, peace came with a price. Aren't you glad that that price has been paid? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And by his stripes, we are healed. Listen, if you need healing in your body right now, whatever you need healing from right now, I want you to tell that thing, by his stripes, I am healed. Diabetes, by Jesus' stripes, we are healed. Leave these bodies. Cancer, by Jesus' stripes, we are healed. Leave these bodies. Cataracts, right now, by Jesus' stripes, these eyes are healed. Deafness, tinnitus in the ear, right now, by his stripes, these people are healed. Right now, liver damage, by his stripes, these people are healed. In Jesus' name. Listen, you don't have to hang on to anything Christ didn't get you at the cross. Return to sender. Address unknown. Hey, listen, the devil may send it to you, but it ain't for you. Amen. If Jesus' blood didn't purchase it, it ain't for you today. And you can just give it that Heisman. I don't think so. You can, listen, I'm telling you, can you do that? Yes, you can. Because this is the temple of the Holy Ghost. And it's up to us to determine, is there more Holy Ghost or more sickness? Because I believe that the power of the Holy Spirit in each and every one of us is wanting to release resurrection power that's going to go to work from the inside out. And there's going to be like a second atom bomb that goes off in this place that's going to cause the love of the Lord just to boosh through this room and just hit not only everybody here, but to send healing to family members and to friends who have been afflicted with cancer and COPD, leukemia. We had a woman healed of COPD on Sunday in the baptism. She got in. She got saved. She gave her heart to the Lord. We had, I think it was 24 people give their hearts to Jesus on Sunday morning. Let's thank the Lord for that. We had one person that up until previous Wednesday was a practicing witch, and they had me come preach a funeral. Don't have me preach a funeral. Listen, we're all about resurrection power. Jesus messed up every funeral he's ever been to, and I've messed up a bunch myself. But man, we were there to honor what had been, but we were committed to who was there in the moment. And we just began to preach the gospel. And it was interesting, this one person who had vehemently opposed me coming to preach this funeral because they wanted it to go a different way. All of a sudden, she was one of the first people to get saved. Her husband, her son, right there. I said, do you understand what you're doing? Right now, you're renouncing witchcraft. You're renouncing the occult. You're renouncing Wiccan right now. And you're saying that you want to live the rest of your life for Jesus Christ. She says, yes, I want this freedom. I want this light. Whatever this is that I feel right now, I want it for the rest of my life. She showed up on Sunday. She and her family were water baptized to the glory of God, buried with Christ, raised in newness of life. I tell you that to say, the devil tries to tell you you're too far gone or God won't use you. I want to tell you, the more the enemy has opposed you, the more God wants to promote you. The more the devils try to come at you, the more that God wants to begin to raise you up as a token of God's glory and a token of God's grace. You know why God uses me? Because he gets all the glory. People look at him, they go, hey, listen, we knew who Jason Hooper was. Man, that boy, he wasn't too smart. He wasn't too gifted. He made a lot of mistakes, but all of a sudden when he gave his life to Jesus, things began to start happening. Amen. And I'm telling you, listen, God's power is not dependent upon your natural ability. It's not dependent upon your pedigree. It's not dependent upon your neighborhood. It's not dependent upon your gender, your race, your denomination. It is not by might. It is not by power, but it is by his spirit, says the Lord. And he will use the foolish things and the foolish ones to confound the wise. Because when God does something great through simple men, God gets the glory. How many of you recognize that God is wanting to do something great in and through your life? Amen. That he might get the glory. Paul was asked, he said, listen, he said, I could put a whole bunch of faith and a whole bunch of trust in my ability. I speak a bunch of languages. I'm learned. I'm the apostle of apostles. I could do this, this, and that. He said, but honestly, I just choose to preach Christ and Christ crucified. That your faith would not be in my ability, but in the power of the cross, the power of the resurrection, and the gospel of Jesus Christ. One of the things I love about Paul is he started off early in his ministry saying, man, I'm the apostle of apostles. I am it, Jack. And the more he matured in Christ, the less he thought he was. There's something of maturing in Christ where you recognize more and more that it really isn't about you. That you recognize that your righteousness is but filthy rags. That it's all because of him. It's all because of Jesus. It's all because of God so loving the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believe on him would have eternal, everlasting life. Not just an eternal destination, but a present revelation. Because Jesus said in John 17:3, eternal life is this, to know the Father and the Son whom he has sent. Folks, I want to tell you, eternal life doesn't start with your last breath. It starts with your next breath. As you begin to release the breath of heaviness and you take on the garment of praise. Let me tell you some of what Christ did for us at the cross. At the cross, Christ became your sin so you could become his righteousness. 2 Corinthians 5:21 says, for he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. At the cross, Christ became your sickness so you could become his healing. At the cross, Christ took on your heaviness so you could put on his garment of praise. At the cross, Christ became your ashes so you could become his beauty. At the cross, Christ became rejected so you could be accepted. At the cross, Christ became your sadness so you could receive his joy. At the cross, Christ became your shame so you could receive his honor. At the cross, Christ became your lust so you could become his love. At the cross, Christ became your bondage, your addiction, so you could receive his freedom. At the cross, Christ became what was at work to kill you, so you could receive life himself. At the cross, Christ emptied himself of reputation, taking the form of a bondservant, so you could be a son. And here's what I want to tell you. Today is a day that God is wanting to call each and every one of us into resurrection life, but I'm telling you, we got to go through the cross to get to resurrection. Jesus set the example. Jesus set the example. Jesus was willing to die to what people thought about him. Jesus was willing to die to the opinions and the preferences of men. Jesus, the man who was put on the cross by the very folks that he came to heal. For some of them, one of the first things they saw with their eyes was the crucifixion of the man who opened their eyes. For some of them, one of the first things that they heard was the man groaning on the inside that had opened their deaf ears to hear. For some of them, the first mountain or the first hill they ever climbed was the hill to climb the man who their sin, their bondage, their thoughts, their actions had put on the cross. And he looked at each and every one of them and said this, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. Because so often, like them, we choose when given a choice, Barabbas or Jesus. Choose what's going to please your flesh, what's going to get yours, or what's going to please your Father and be the expression of his Son in the earth. And I want to tell you, listen, today's not a day to choose Barabbas, it's a day to choose Jesus. Today's a day to say, listen, I want resurrection life, but I'm going to go through the cross to get there. Because if I was honest today, there's some things that I'm carrying in my life. There's some things that he nailed to the cross. There's some bondage. There's some sickness. There's some things that I've allowed to be a part of who I am that he said that he was taking on him so it no longer had to be a part of who I was. How many of you here today, you've been carrying some things in your body that Christ bore at the cross? That bondage, that addiction, that sickness, that lust, that shame, those things that were trying to kill you, that sin. But today you say, listen, I want to come to the cross. I want to lay down my sin that I could become his righteousness. On the count of three, I'm going to give you a choice. I'm going to give you an opportunity today to enter into resurrection life. And it's not just about an eternal destination. It is. You will go to heaven when you die, when you pray this prayer. But it's more about having a present revelation, because I'm telling you, Jesus did not just die to get you into heaven. He died to get heaven into you. And he's not after, listen, he's not just after decisions for salvation. He's after lives surrendered that he can occupy and he can possess here in the earth. Amen. When the lame man at the gate beautiful was raised up from his sick bed, the people of the city began to look to Peter and John as though through their righteousness or their power they had done this great work. And this is what Peter said. Let it be known to you all and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by him this man stands before you whole. Nor is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 10, verse 32, whoever confesses me before men, whoever publicly acknowledges me as Lord, I will also confess before my Father who is in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, I will also deny before my Father who is in heaven. And I want to ask you, are our actions confessing the Lord a public acknowledgement that Jesus is the Lord of my life? Or they deny and say, you know what, I'm going to choose Barabbas today, and maybe tomorrow I'll choose Jesus. I want to tell you, tomorrow is not promised. The only thing we have is today. And so on the count of three, if you have something that you need to nail on this cross, you have sin, you have sickness, you have bondage that needs to be laid down so you can begin to take up that resurrection life. Take up that cross that he told you to walk with. On the count of three, I want you to raise your hand. One. Two, three. Come on, if that's you, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, if your hand's up, I want you to stand up right now. We're going to celebrate right now. Come on, if that's you, come on down. Come on, everybody, get out of your seat. Come to the front right now. Come on, if your hand's up, what you're doing is you're saying, listen, I can't live this life in my strength. I can't live this life according to my will and my ways. I'm making a decision today to allow my life to be crucified with Christ. No longer do I live, but the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by faith. Come on, let's thank the Lord for these brave, brave daughters and sons of God. Amen. Come on, everybody, just come on up here. And we're going to pray something together. That is an awesome shirt, my friend. God bless you, sir. God bless you. I love your spirit. Hey, let's thank the Lord for these amazing sons and daughters of the Lord. Come on, anyone else? Come. 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 Amen. Come on down. Frankie, go ahead and turn around so everybody can see that beautiful face. Come on now. Rocking that do-rag. My friend. Come on. Hallelujah. Gloria. Come on. Hey, listen, this is what we're going to say together. Now, listen, what you're saying is, listen, if you're not up here, okay, what you're saying is that you've already professed Jesus as Lord. Amen? Because, listen, I don't want anyone to leave here lost. I've got a responsibility to not just feed you naturally, but to say, listen, Jesus said this in John chapter 6. You guys can go. You're just all filling up here. I know we've got a lot of folks up here. What's up, Melba? How we doing?
We're doing fine. How are you?
Good to see you. Jesus said this in John chapter 6. He said, listen, I'm the bread that came down from heaven. Listen, those honey butter biscuits ain't got nothing on him. Amen. Hallelujah. I love me a honey butter biscuit. But he said, I am the bread that came down from heaven. He said, he who believes in me will never hunger, and he who comes to me will never thirst. Come on, is there anybody else out there that's hungry for him, that's thirsty for him, that has not yet given your life to Jesus? If so, I want you to come right now. Don't delay. This is your day. Amen. Let's say this together. I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Hallelujah. All right, let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, come on, listen. So most people say every head bowed and every eye closed. I don't like that. Jesus said, watch and pray lest you fall into temptation. Listen, you miss a lot of stuff praying with your eyes closed. There is no scripture that says bow your head and close your eyes. Listen, that was a bunch of men not wanting you to see what happened when they prayed. I'll tell you, the best thing you can do is keep your eyes open because stuff happens. Amen. And so every head up, every eye open, every mouth open, let's declare together, amen, ready. Say, Lord Jesus, I ask you to come into my heart, to make me a new creation. I declare that I'm not what I did. I'm what you've done. I receive your grace. I receive your mercy. And I ask you to fill me with the power of your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's give the Lord a shout of praise. Hallelujah. 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 Now, let me ask you. I know we've got Bibles we're going to hand out to everyone up here. But if you're here today, one of the things I want to strongly encourage you to do is to be water baptized. We've got the water already poured. Listen, nice little 88 degrees. It's nice in there, I'm telling you. But listen, we've got shorts, we've got shirts, we've got towels. You will not lose your place in line. But it is in water baptism. Paul said in Romans chapter 6 that we enter into the death and the burial of the Lord Jesus Christ. We enter into the death and the burial of the Lord Jesus Christ. When we come out of that water, we come out in newness of life. Is your name Miss Honey? That's amazing. Honey. I preached a whole sermon 2 Sundays ago on honey butter. Miss Honey, is there a Mr. Butter in the house? Let's make some biscuits. Amen. Hallelujah. Anybody? That's your sister? Praise the Lord. Hey, come on now. Let me ask you this. How many of you say, listen, I don't want to just pray a prayer. There's some things here that I want to leave behind. I want to be buried with Christ and raised in newness of life. If that's you, raise your hand right now. Come on. Praise the Lord. Listen, what you're saying is you want to be baptized. All right? How many of you want to be baptized? All right? Awesome. If you want to be baptized, listen, here's what I'm going to do. D, this beautiful looking man over here in this green shirt. Looking like a lime popsicle on a hot day. Come on now. If you want to be baptized, I'm going to ask you to go with D. They're going to get you shorts. They're going to get you shirt. You're going to get towel. You will not lose your place in line. But I can tell you this in the name of Jesus. I have never seen it fail. We've baptized over 2,500 people in that water in the last year and a half. And every single person that has got in that water has had a God encounter, whether it be a deliverance, whether it be an outward transformation on their face of an inward posture. Lord, we've seen sickness go. We've got testimonies of HIV being healed in that water. We've got testimonies of Hep C, COPD, cancer, people getting brand new livers. Terry was in there, had a cataract fall off her eye. I want to tell you this. If you've got stuff that you need to nail on the cross, I'm telling you, you've got stuff that you need to bury in the water. And so if you're here right now and you want to be water baptized, whether you're up here or you're back here, I want you to go with D. Now listen, I want to tell you this. A lot of churches have this weird thing that to be a part of their church, you got to get baptized. That ain't us. If you get baptized here, that does not commit you to this church in any way. You get baptized here, all it does is commit Christ. You ever heard that? People say, listen, to be here, you got to be baptized. That's crap. I'm sorry. I've already given the altar call. I can be honest now. Bam. I'm just kidding. That is a doctrine of man meant to control your free will. That is not Jesus. Being baptized in a certain church does not declare I felt that religious spirit pucker up. That does not create an allegiance or a loyalty to a building or to a man. When you're getting baptized, what you're getting baptized into is Christ. What you're saying is, I don't want to be who I've been. I don't want to live the way that I've lived. I want to live for the Lord Jesus. Amen? And listen, if you've been told that, I ask you forgiveness on behalf of whoever told you because they were wrong. Amen? Amen. All right, let's go ahead and hand Bibles out to everybody up here. Again, all of the baptisms, if you could follow D-Money, that beautiful lime popsicle. Come on, let's thank the Lord for D-Money. I love me some D-Money. Hallelujah. That's a good color on D. How many of you are thankful for D Money? Listen, if it wasn't for D and his amazing team of volunteers, we wouldn't have food on Tuesdays. Amen. How many of you are thankful for D Money and his amazing team of volunteers? Hallelujah. Amen. I'm going to ask Pastor Jeff to come on down and tell us what to do next. Man, look how great Pastor Jeff looks. Come on now. Hallelujah. From the Easter collection.
Morning. How you doing? Good to see you.
Hey, let me ask you this. I know that we declared by his stripes we are healed, but how many of you this morning, you felt signs and symptoms of sickness leave your body? If so, I want you to raise both hands and begin to wave them right now. Come on, if you felt signs and symptoms of sickness leave your body, just begin to wave both hands right now. Hallelujah! 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 Look at that. That is amazing. Come on. Listen, that is to the glory of Jesus Christ. Amen? Shout out some of what left your body. Yes, what left your body? What left? You felt cataracts leave your eyes. Amen. So your eyes can see now what you couldn't see before. Praise the Lord. Come on now. Hallelujah. Who else? Signs and symptoms left your body. Huh?
Pain in my wrist is gone.
Pain in your wrist is gone. Who else? Who else felt signs and symptoms? Yes, shout it out. You just felt that strength hit your body where you felt weak. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Who else has felt signs and symptoms leave your body? Amen. Anyone else? Anyone else has sickness leave your body when we prayed earlier? Come on, let's thank the Lord for these amazing testimonies. Hallelujah. What's your name today?
Angelique.
Angelique, that's beautiful. What's Jesus doing in your heart today?
Make him full of love.
Amen. Amen. Well, according to the testimony of your faith, Angelique, and the Great Commission to baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, we baptize you in the name of the Lord Jesus. Amen. What's your name today, sir?
My name is Trenton.
Awesome. And what's Jesus doing in your heart today?
He's recreating my whole soul and body, and I give thanks to him. My lifestyle is completely, it's changing, changing rapidly. And I just pray and help God and say, oh God, you understand, and make me a better man.
Amen.
I have problems. I have a whole lot of problems. I have problems with my anxiety. I have problems with my panic attack. And I have problems with my nerves, you know. And he's slowly, you understand, blessing me. He's slowly changing my life and my lifestyle that I've been living. And I just give thanks to him. And I want you to pray for me so I can get over this sickness.
Amen.
Okay.
I'm going to pray for you right now. The anxiety, the panic attacks, and the sickness. Go ahead and look at me in the eye. Testimony of your faith in Jesus Christ, according to the Great Commission to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We baptize you in the name of the Lord Jesus. And I want you to pray this with me. Say, Lord Jesus, I ask you to fill me with your Holy Spirit and power. Take away the anxiety. Take away the fear. Take away the doubt. Take away the death. Hear that bubbling up in your belly? That's the Holy Ghost. Just start putting your voice with it right there, and that depression is going to leave and joy is going to come. That's it. That's it. Just let it flow from your belly. Don't worry about trying to figure it out up here. Just let it flow from right here. That's it. You got it. That's it. How you feel?
Amen.
Bless you, my friend. Absolutely. That's what I'm here for. All right, my sister. I'm going to step right here.
Okay.
I've got you. Okay. Amen. 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 One more step to the bottom. Amen. So what's your name today?
Irene.
Irene, what's Jesus doing in your heart?
Jesus, I know you love me. I know he just loved me. I just want to be repent.
Amen.
And he gave me love and joy in my heart.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen. Well, Father, I thank you for Irene. I think the name Irene means peace.
Yes.
Doesn't it?
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Yeah. As soon as I said that, I saw the name Irene when it was actually, it's Irenic, and because it's in talks about in Luke when they were talking about the Prince of Peace, when the angels came proclaiming the Lord, and it actually has that word Irenic. Your name is part of the proclamation of the gospel.
Oh.
Hey. Hey, so listen, it's the Prince of Irene, Jesus, his lordship, his rule, his reign in your life. Amen. And so, Father, I thank you for Irene. I thank you for the testimony of her faith. God, I thank you, Lord, that she would fully embody her name as the peace of God. Lord, I thank you, Lord, that when she steps into a situation, your peace steps with her. In Jesus' name, thank you, Holy Spirit. Right now, in the name of Jesus, I break off accusation and rejection. I felt pain right here in my left shoulder blade. Right now, it was almost like this feeling in my back and in the back. Like love and loss right now. I thank you, Holy Spirit. What's your name?
I'm Stephanie Egler.
Stephanie, what's Jesus doing in your heart today?
He is doing something awesome. He wants me to come back to him. I left him about a year and 5 months, but I was walking with him for a year and 3 months, and I walked away from him. He wants me back.
Amen. And so today you're coming back to Jesus. Amen. According to the testimony of your faith and according to the Great Commission to baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, we baptize you in the name of the Lord Jesus. And I want to tell you, listen, the Lord, he never got tired of waiting because he knew you were worth it. And so listen, I break even the power of regret off of your soul right now. That feeling like you've wasted time or you've lost days, that's a lie. It's impossible, because with our God, 1,000 years is a day is 1,000 years. He can do in one day what it would take man 1,000 years to do. And today, God is doing that work in you. Amen? So pray this when you say, Lord Jesus.
Jesus,
I ask you to fill me with your Holy Spirit.
With your Holy Spirit.
In Jesus' name. Come on, Spirit of Adoption is coming on you right now.
Yes.
Amen. That last step's a doozy. It is. What's your name?
Philip.
Philip. You know, Philip was the first New Testament evangelist. In John chapter 1, verse 43, Jesus called a man named Philip out of Bethsaida. And Bethsaida meant the fishery house. And Philip went around telling everybody that he had found Jesus. And people didn't believe that he had found Jesus. In fact, there was a guy named Nathanael. And Nathanael said, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" That was his response to Philip when Philip said he had found Jesus. Because they knew Philip, they knew the life that he had lived. He was a fisherman. And back then, that was kind of like the rough and tough group of guys. You know, that, you know, if somebody was getting into somebody, it was a fisherman. And so what happened was when he said, "Listen, we found the one that we heard was coming," Nathanael, number one, doubted Philip. And then number two, he doubted the Lord. Because he said, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" And Nazareth, the root word of Nazareth is Netzer, and Netzer means branch. And Jesus said in John 15, "He is the vine, we are the branch." And really what Nathanael was asking is, can anything good come out of the church? Can anything good come out of people who, as a branch, claim a relationship to Jesus as the vine? And this is what Jesus did. He saw Nathanael coming afar off, and he said, "Behold, an Israelite in whom there is no deceit, there is no guile." And what he did was he saw who he was. He removed the labels of what he had done, all of the things that people had said about him, about being dishonest, being a man of little character and integrity and dishonorable, and all of those kind of things that had been said about Nathanael. Jesus said, "That's not who you are." And this is what happened. Nathanael said, "You know me." And when he said, "You know me," all of a sudden he recognized, he said, "You are the Christ. You are the Son of the living God." And what he was saying was, "I doubted if anything good could come out of the church. But when I found out that Jesus knew me, he loved me, and he wanted me just as I am, he was willing to remove the labels of that everyone else had placed on my life and call me out of that place of isolation into a place of really knowing who I am," that answered his call. How do I know that? Yeah, I know. Well, I kind of have this thing where I hear God, and when I hear him speaking, I just have to say it. And that's one of the things that honestly all...
This is no game.
I know.
How do you know that kind of relates to me?
Well, because I hear things. Jesus said his sheep know his voice, and he wants you to know his voice just like I do. And so a lot of times I hear God in my heart, or I can hear God in my ear, and I hear God telling me things about people. Not to tell me about to expose, but to tell me so I can take it off of people. And so when I can see things, and a lot of times I can look into people's eyes and I can tell you what's going on in their heart. And when I see that, that's a gift that God gave me, but it's also a gift that God wants to give you. You may call it a premonition, okay? Because you've had premonitions before, but God is wanting to sanctify that in the water today to where it's not premonition, but it's a spirit of prophecy. It's discernment. Because discernment is being able to see what something is. Philippians 1:9 says we could grow in all love, all knowledge, and all discernment. And see, when you've had, in times past, you've had premonitions that cause you to be suspicious of people, their motives, and why they do what they do. But God is wanting to bring you out of a place of suspicion that's rooted in fear of loss of what people would try to take from you if you let them get too close, to a discernment to where you recognize that you've already been given all that could be given and nobody can take anything from you. Amen? And that's part of why God brought you here today. It's part of why God brought you to be saved, to be baptized, to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And so you could hear God the same way that I hear God. Because you notice when I'm saying this, there's no point of the finger. There's invitation to come up higher. Everything I'm saying, I'm not saying to put anything on you. I'm saying to take things off of you. And that's what Jesus came to do. He came to remove every yoke and destroy every burden. Amen? Does it make sense? It
makes sense.
Awesome. Does it, so that speaks to your heart?
It does. It relates to me in many ways. I just want to wash off all the crud, all the dirt, start fresh again. Amen. You know, there's things I can't go back and make up for, and I want to let that go.
It all stays in the water.
I want to let that go. I want to be a new person for me and my wife. And a death in my family caused me to turn and make this 360. I haven't been with the Lord since I graduated high school. And I went to Catholic school all my life. So,
well, today, listen, you're going to go from having known about God to knowing God. Amen? Come on, let's pray.
Take this addiction away too.
I saw it. I'm taking it out in the name of Jesus. Father, right now, God, I just thank you for Philip. God, I break the power of all bondage that has come against him. And I even felt like almost like a stabbing pain in my right foot, like just below my big toe. Like almost like, you know, like how like the lion,
You know, there's like that story when the lion got the thorn in his paw, and it took him from being this image of great authority and the king of the jungle to being kind of like weak and you know, this kind of thing. And there's some things that you stepped on that created pain to where it actually robbed you of your authority and it caused you to back up and to feel weak. But today's the day you're going to get your strength back. Today's the day that thorn is going to be taken out of your foot. That's it. Okay. All right. Look me in the eyes, though.
Stay in this water. I command you to be loosed from his life. I thank you that even appetites are going to change when he gets up out of this water. That he's not going to want the same things he wanted. He's not going to have the cravings physically, mentally, or emotionally that he's had in times past. And I thank you that he who the Son sets free is free indeed. And so, Father, right now, hey, do you got any oil? Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, I command that spirit of addiction to leave your life. I break your assignment against my brother right now in Jesus' name. And it's almost like when you let somebody off of work, I relieve this demon of its duty right now. I declare to be unemployed as it comes to your life right now in Jesus' name. And I want you to pray this when you say, Lord Jesus, I ask you to fill me with your Holy Spirit. I break agreement with addiction and bondage and anger and hatred and rage. And I ask you to fill my heart with your truth, with your love, in Jesus' name. You feel that bubbling right there? That's the Holy Spirit. Just open your mouth and just let those sounds come out. That's it. You feel that bubbling. Just put your voice with it right now. Don't even worry about trying to figure out what it is. There it is. There it's coming. That's it. God, I thank you, Lord, for taking those 1,000 pounds off my brother's shoulders right now in the name of Jesus. God, I thank you. Come on, you feel that freedom? You feel that joy? Just let it out. Just let it out with your voice. That's it. Come on, he saved you. He's baptized you. He's filled you. Come on, you're a new man. You're not what you've done. You're what he did. Come on, all darkness stays in the water right now in Jesus' name. That spirit has left you. He says that he will not leave you. He will not forsake you. He'll be with you all the days of your life in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Absolutely. That's what I'm here for. Amen. I believe Derek's got a word for you too.